Welcome back to our laboratory of the endless exploration of Chernobyl technologies. So today we have for you a very massive piece of computer history, let's say in a quite literal meaning, because this thing is one of the very first Soviet computer hard drives. It was produced in Bulgaria by Zot in the mid of the 80s, and exactly the same, widely used in the Chernobyl exclusion zone as a part of PDP-11 computer systems that worked for various scientific and engineering tasks. But this thing in particular came to us from completely another place, and unfortunately, first who got their hands on it were metal scrappers, so it misses some parts. Nevertheless, here is pretty much interesting. But I'm pretty happy it actually is a little bit damaged, because even in this condition, it weighs approximately 45 kilograms, which is roughly 100 pounds. So to be honest, I'm praying that my table will not collapse when I will do some teardown. Don't move. And before we continue, I have some news for you. So as you probably noticed, our technical episodes and reviews of various Chernobyl hardware not coming the same often as before. And unfortunately, there is a serious reason behind, because nowadays in Ukraine we have really serious problems with energy supply. You know why. So that makes it really problematic to record something in the lab. We are doing our best. And our health kitchen is going on. So don't worry, this month something truly jaw-dropping will come out. Spoiler alert. Well, actually, this is just a half of what we need, but if you already have a guess about what exactly we are going to build, share it in the comments. In the meantime, do not forget to check our new series about the history of Chernobyl. It is based on our very long experience at that place, and we put much love in it, so we hope you will learn a lot new and interesting. And now back to our hero. So technically, this hard drive is quite an approximate clone of RK05 by Digital Equipment Corporation. And at first glance it looks pretty much as a normal hard disk, but a few times upscaled. But of course, there are a few differences. So here we have this huge and powerful motor. It rotates a 14-inch built-in disk with capacity of 25 megabytes. Well, we will reach that disk a bit later, because now it is hidden under this large black panel, and now what is possible is just to see its edge. But in addition to that, you can install here one more extra disk in this opening. We have a brand new disk packet like this, it's still sealed in plastic, so a bit later we will try to place it here as well. Next, here is a mechanical system of brushes for automatic cleaning of the disks. This is what it looks like. And below all this hardware, there is a large blower which distributes air into the disk compartment. Then there is a huge liner actuator and assembly of four heads. They are connected to this read and write channel card. Next to it is emergency heads parking system, and here was a very huge power supply. All that was controlled with a stack of cards which were installed here. Now let's look at the front. So here is a standard panel with various switches and indicators. When this start switch is off, all electromechanical parts are off as well. And this loading indicator will signalize you can install the removable disk. Then, once the disk is installed, we turn the start switch to initiate the start sequence. The main motor will start to rotate and heads will be positioned at the cylinder 0. After that, this green ready indicator will start to glow. There is also a button for write protection, which glows if protection is active, and if you press it in this state, it will switch the protection off. As you see, all of this is rack mount, because it was meant to be installed into the standard rack of SM-AVM. If that name is not familiar to you, those were a large line of Soviet mini computers created starting from the end of the 70s. Some of them were compatible by commands with HP 2000 and DEC VAX, but vast majority were PDP-11 architectural clones. And compared to Soviet IBM 360 clones, which we talked about many times in the past, SMAware mostly were quite reliable and easy to service. So logically that when after the Chernobyl disaster appeared a lot of tasks that required computing, SMAware became the best and cheap choice. And if you go to the city of Pripyat, you can find a lot of evidence of this. For example, at Jupiter plant, there were many SM1420 control minicomputers produced at the electron mesh factory in Kiev. Well, in their capabilities, they were very close to DEC PDP-11/45, which was released nearly a decade before, but for tasks in the zone, that was quite sufficient. And still, it is possible to see remains of those computers just in the windows of the administrative and engineering buildings. Each SM1420 rack had at least one or maximum two hard drives like ours. Additionally, in 1987, based on similar SM minicomputers, was created the very first system of the radiation dose accounting. There is this building in Pripyat where the radiation safety department was based during the early period. And there it's possible to find pieces of the same removable hard disks. On them was stored a monthly data about radiation doses the Chernobyl staff received during their daily work. Well, that of course were just a few examples. And now let's take a look inside. We've got some original documentation which actually greatly helped to understand how missing parts had to look. Okay, so first let's remove this gray upper panel. It is secured by a few hexagonal posts and screws. As far as I remember, here also had to be one more protective lid, which gets blocked for opening when the drive is operating. We also need to remove a transparent cover over the brushes. Okay, this is how many parts were holding this panel. Okay, so now I can remove it. Stop, I forgot to disconnect this rotary switch. This switch is basically a lock which signalized that the removable disc is installed. Okay, next I need to remove this sensor. I guess it was supposed to register the rotation speed, but actually I'm not sure because its purpose absolutely not explained in documentation. Or maybe it's temperature sensor, well, unfortunately I really don't know. And next I need to remove the next portion of hexagonal posts. And here comes our 14-inch built-in 25 MB disk. Unfortunately, its surface is very damaged and itself it's very dusty, so I will clean it and let it dry. In the meantime, let's look at the built-in cleaning system. It consists of two brushes, which are moved across the surface using this small motor. And if you look at the bottom of the drive, we can see the mechanism of it. And there are these two metal panels, so behind the upper panel there is a turbine which pumps air through the disks. But what is behind the bottom one I honestly do not know, so let's look there first. Well, to be honest, I will be not surprised if there is just a huge brick, because after all, this weight has to come from something. I see, there is just a huge filter. Okay, now let's take a look at the turbine. So, it is powered by the main motor via this rubber belt. The temperature on the disks must not exceed 45 degrees Celsius, so this is why the constant flow of air is needed. And if I remove this panel, this is what we have inside. Well, given that the main motor provides 2400 RPM, this had to generate a really strong flow of air. So this is it. The blower creates a strong flow of air which cools down the drive, which obviously becomes quite hot, and here below everything is open. So the air goes out, passes the filter and then continues to disks through these four openings. Well, in fact, if I rotate it even manually, the flow of air is enough strong to feel it on a hand. Okay, and now let's take a look at the head assembly and their actuator. I need a bit more space here, so I will remove what remained from power supply. For this I need to disconnect these two connectors, which wire up the main motor and head's actuator, and remove three screws. And here we have the actuator in its beauty. There are four heads, which are connected to read-write channel card. And using the actuator, the heads should move like this. Of course, in functional drive they must not touch the surface, otherwise disk and heads will be severely damaged. Well, with this very particular disk it happened already so many times that it doesn't matter anymore. But in a live setup, the heads had to keep a few microns distance, and our senior colleagues thought that calibrating them was kind of a rocket science. There are multiple screws here you need to adjust, and normally there was a standard disc based on which the calibration has been made. And next, there is a head sparking system, which was made in quite interesting way. So as you see, there are two large capacitors, which have a monstrous capacity of 82,000 microfarads each. So in the case of power loss, if voltage on those capacitors went below certain threshold, this relay would trigger. This would make a capacitor discharge right into the actuator, which would instantly retract the head assembly, saving the disc. Well, if you excuse me, I will not disassemble the actuator because it is secured in such a way that I would need to disassemble entire drive for this, and honestly, it's way too heavy. Instead, I assembled everything back and let's look at removable disc. So, the disc has a handle with a built-in lock and it secures in position a bottom cover which protects the disc from dust and dirt. Once you remove it, the packet is ready for installing, and then, if you place it back, it gets automatically locked. There is a little problem. So, this appeared to be a double disc packet, not a single one as we need. Well, I didn't know because it was sealed in plastic. This has the same dimensions as we need, but likely it will not fit correctly into the drive. Because yes, there is a corresponding part for drive spindle, but there is no opening for that small sensor inside the drive. In other respects, the disc is almost the same as we need. So, in the drive there are these four keys, and in the disc there are four openings which have to match them. So, this is approximately how you have to position the disc. It unfortunately doesn't fit completely, but I guess you get the idea. And once the disc is installed, all we need to do is to turn the switch and it is ready to go. So, this is it. I think that this particular device will donate to our friends from Software and Computer Museum because, to be honest, even in this quite damaged condition, it still can be a really interesting exhibit. But besides, if by the chance any of you will appear here in Kiev, you can visit State Polytechnical Museum and there they have a SM5400 mini computer in the condition of workpool, and it has a few of these drives but completely intact, so you can see them there. And that's it for today. Don't forget to check our Patreon page. I will upload some bonus reading about this device, and you can find there a lot of Chernobyl insights, various details on Chernobyl technologies, various things about the elimination of consequences of Chernobyl disaster, various research data, translations, and much more. Link is in the description below. And this is it, and see you next time.
Don't move. Don't move. Don't move. Don't move. Don't move.